In this video, I will introduce the basic idea of sampling distribution. Central Limit Theorem, also known as a CLT, it is the backbone of sampling distribution and also one of the most important statistical theorems will also be introduced here. We will also see how the sampling distribution is applied to some examples at the end of this video. Let's begin. You may remember from one of the earlier videos that samples are very important to understand populations. I've drawn two circles on this slide. The bigger circle refers to a population, while the smaller circle represents a sample drawn from this population. Many times, we try to answer questions regarding population parameters. For example, what's the average American income? That's the population mean mu. Or, is a car ownership in America more than 50%? That's the population proportion greater than 50%. To answer these questions regarding population parameters, we try to sample a random sample from this population and take a look at the corresponding sample statistics instead. They would be the sample mean x bar, sample proportion p bar for the two questions I just described. Because sample statistics are so useful in understanding the population parameters, in this video, we will see how we can better understand the properties of those sample statistics. For example, we may be interested in answering the following questions. Is the sample mean x bar equals to 65 close to the true population mean? Does the sample proportion p bar of 0.54 imply the population proportion p more than 50%? The properties, or more specifically, the sampling distributions of the sample statistics can be explained using the Central Limit Theorem, which is also known as a CLT. I have found a YouTube video that explains this concept very well. It's called Bunnies, Dragons, and the Normal World, the Central Limit Theorem. Please pause this video here and click on the video in the top right corner of this screen. Let's summarize what we have just learned from the Bunnies and Dragons video. When we gather a bunch of n objects, that's our sample. The average of these n objects, also known as the sample mean, is usually denoted as x bar, frequently follows a normal distribution. The mean, or the center of this normal distribution, is the same as population mean, which is usually denoted as a mu. The spread, or the standard deviation of this normal distribution, is smaller than the population standard deviation sigma. More specifically, the standard deviation of this normal distribution is the population standard deviation sigma divided by the square root of sample size. The video we just watched only talks about the sampling distribution of the sample mean. In fact, the sampling distribution of the sample proportion also follows a normal distribution using the CLT. The mean of this normal distribution is the same as population proportion P, and the standard deviation of this normal distribution is the square root of the population proportion P multiplied by 1 minus P divided by the sample size. Again, we have seen square root n shown up in the denominator of the standard deviation of the normal distribution. When our sample size increases, meaning when we take more and more elements in our sample, n goes up. The standard deviation of the normal distribution, in fact, decreases. This suggests that the shape of a normal curve becomes narrower and more centered at the mean. That's why we often say averaging reduces variability. There are some requirements on the size of the samples we have to draw from the population in order for the Central Limit Theorem to work. Usually, they cannot be too small. For more details on this, please check out other videos linked in the upper right corner of this screen. Let's look at several questions related to the sampling distribution. First, How many possible samples of size n can we get out of population? Say the population here is all Americans. You'd like to draw a random sample of 25 Americans each time. There are different ways to do that. Sample 1, 25 Americans. Sample 2, another 25 Americans. Sample 3 and sample 4, so on and so forth. How many possible ways of drawing unique samples of size 25 from our population? Well, let's look at a slightly different problem. If we try to draw a sample of 25 from a population of 100, we know the total number of different ways to do that is 242 followed by 21 zeros. That's only from a small population of 100. If we consider all Americans for this question, the number will be much bigger. From each one of the samples, we can calculate one sample mean. That's one x bar, and another x bar, and so on and so forth. The sampling distribution of all the x bars is indeed related to the overall distribution of these x bars. For question 2, for each sample of size n, we can calculate sample size x bar. If we can get all the possible samples of size n and calculate all the possible sample means, what does the distribution of this sample mean look like? I think you may have an answer to this after watching the Bunnies and Dragons video. Yes, the distribution looks like a bell curve according to the Central Limit Theorem. The spread of the curve, that's the standard deviation, is smaller than the spread of original population standard deviation, as we have discussed earlier. Nevertheless, the distribution is still a bell curve. Thus, we can see that a Central Limit Theorem is a very powerful tool in statistics. It guarantees that the sample means and the sample proportions are all normally distributed. And we do like normal distributions because they are easiest to comprehend compared to all other distributions. And we can usually calculate the probabilities using Excel or Z tables. Last but not least, we also know that we can use the empirical rules for sample means and the sample proportions because all of them are normally distributed. For a quick review of empirical rule, please check out my other videos linked in the upper right corner. From the empirical rule, we know that 68% of the sample means should be within one standard deviation, also known as a standard error of the population mean. That's also true mean we try to estimate. Similarly, there's a 95% chance that any selected sample means will be within two standard errors of the true mean. You may remember that we use sigma to represent the population standard deviation. For the spread of the sampling distribution of the sample means, which is different from sigma, but sigma divided by square root n, I will use sigma with a subscript x bar to represent it. From the Central Limit Theorem, we know the distribution of all the sample means is normal, a bell curve. The center of this distribution is the same as the population mean, which is mu. So mu x bar is the same as mu, as we can see here. The spread of this distribution is represented using sigma x bar is sigma divided by square root n, so much smaller than sigma. This is also from averaging reduces variability, which we have talked about earlier. Let's use one example to consolidate all these concepts. We are interested in finding the average household income in the state of Oregon. There are about 1.7 million households here in Oregon. We do not have enough time and resources to conduct a census. The Central Limit Theorem tells us that when we pick a random sample size of 1,000 households and calculate the sample average household income using this 1,000 households, there is a very good chance that this sample average income is close to the true population average income. What do we mean by close here? According to the empirical rule, we know that, on average, 95% of the time, this sample average is within two more precisely 1.96 standard deviations away from the true population average. Let's take a look at the central limit theorem applied to the sample proportions. Again, we know the distribution of all sample proportions is normal, a bell curve. The center of this distribution is the same as the population proportion. So mu p bar is the same as population proportion p. The spread of distribution represented using sigma with a subscript p bar is the square root of a p multiplied by 1 minus p divided by n. If the population proportion p is about 50% or 0.5, we should expect the sample population proportion p bar to be close to 50%. If the sample proportion p bar is more than 3 standard errors above 50%, then the true p is very likely to be more than 50%. This is from the empirical rule. Because we know the sample proportion is within 3 standard errors of the population proportion for 99.7% of the time. So majority of the time, p bar is within 3 standard errors of the p. Let's use a different example to consolidate all these concepts for proportions. We are interested in finding the true proportion of adults in the U.S. who support a president's foreign policy. There are about 260 million adults here in the U.S. The central limit theorem tells us when we pick a random sample of 500 adults and calculate the proportion of these adults in the sample who support a president's foreign policy, there is a pretty good chance that the sample proportion is close to the true population proportion of adults who support a president's foreign policy. I've prepared 2 more examples to show you how we can use the central limit theorem to solve sampling distribution problems. Let's take a look at the first one. The dean of a business school claims that the average weekly income of graduates of a school 1 year after graduation is $600. The standard deviation is assumed to be $120. The first question asks about the likelihood of having 36 randomly selected graduates with an average income of less than $550. To answer this question, we would have to think about the sampling distribution of the sample mean here. From the central limit theorem, we know that the sampling distribution of the sample mean is normal, a bell curve. As we have shown here, the center of this distribution is at 600, which is the same as true population mean. How about the spread, sigma x bar? Is it the same as population standard deviation of $120? It's actually population standard deviation sigma divided by square root of n, the sample size. So that would be 120 divided by the square root of 36. That's 20. So the spread dropped from 120 to 20 when we consider averages. Again, this is related with averaging reduces variability. Now, we have the center and the spread of these normal distributions. They are 600 and 20 respectively. So we can calculate probabilities. To find the likelihood of a randomly selected sample with an average less than 550, we can use norm.dist function Excel. The first argument is 550. The second argument is the mean of this distribution with 600. And the third argument is the standard deviation of this normal distribution, that is 20. And the last argument is true. We have discussed norm.dist and norm.in functions in one of the earlier videos. Check them out by clicking on the video linked in the upper right corner. The output from Excel is 0.0062. So there is about a 0.62% chance that the sample average income will be $550 or less. Part 2 asks us, what do we think about Dean's claim? After learning, the average weekly income of our sample is $550. The dean claims that the average weekly income is $600. If that's indeed the case, the likelihood of getting a $550 average weekly income in a randomly selected sample of 36 students is very unlikely. It is because we calculate the probability to be 0.62%. That's a very, very small percentage. So this actually suggests that the population average income is probably not $600, but much lower than $600. The dean probably inflated the weekly income of her students. The second example is about a marketing firm. This firm claims that 30% of potential consumers intend to purchase a new phone within 6 months. A sample of 100 consumers is selected to examine this claim. What is the probability that a sample contains at least 40 consumers who intend to purchase a new phone? This is also a sampling distribution problem. But instead of a sample mean, this time, we are dealing with sample proportions. One way to differentiate sample mean versus sample proportion problems is to look at the data we are dealing with. In the previous example, we are dealing with incomes. That's numerical data or quantitative data. Here, we are dealing with the proportions of consumers who will purchase a new phone. That's categorical data or qualitative data. For numerical data, we are usually dealing with sample mean problems. And for categorical data, we are usually dealing with sample proportion problems. From the Central Limit Theorem, we know that the sample proportions are normally distributed. The center of this normal distribution is at the population proportion P, that's given to be 30%, or 0.3 here. How about the spread of this normal distribution? We calculate the spread of this normal distribution using this formula. That's the square root of a P multiplied by 1 minus P divided by N. We plug in the numbers here, 0.3 times 0.7 divided by 100, and take the square root of that. That's about 0.046. Now we can use this piece of information to work out the probability. We are interested in finding out the probability of the sample containing at least 40 consumers who intend to purchase a new phone. That's 40 out of 100. That's 40% or 0.4. We would like to find what's the probability that P bar is more than 40% or 0.4. This can be done using norm.dist Excel function. We're looking for the probability of more than. That's a little bit more complicated than the probability of less than. To calculate the probability of less than, we can use norm.dist function. The first argument is going to be 0.4. The second and third arguments are the mean and the standard errors of the distribution of the normal distribution respectively. And the last argument is true. So after we calculate the less than probability, norm.dist function tells us that's 0.985. We can calculate the more than probability. That's 1 minus the 0.985, that's 0.015 or 1.5%. In conclusion, the probability that a sample contains at least 40 consumers who want to purchase a phone is about 1.5%. There are more practice problems posted on our course site. I've also made a few other videos where I worked on sampling distribution problems, either in a lecture or a tutorial session format. Please check them out on YouTube. This also ends this video, and I will see you in the next one.